Thank you for your kind words. Thank you again for having me here. And we are now going to talk about the sulci and gyri. It's the surface, and this is very important because when you, the sulci, with the advent of microneurosurgery, are the landmarks of the brain for microneurosurgery. We have to recognize them in MRIs to know what the tumors, which sulci they are related, at least to know where they are. You don't have to use the sulci. Tomorrow we're going to talk a little bit more about surgery, but you have to recognize where the lesions are in relation to the surface, of course, both in NMR and surgeries. So again, I'm going to start with some 2D slides, and then we put our glasses. Maybe we can have the lights off. I did skip 30 or 40 slides of history that I like very much about the history of anatomy of sulci and gyri for the sake of time. But it's interesting because neuroanatomy man is interested in the brain for so many years since the beginning of everything. You know that the burr holes are the oldest procedure that has ever been done as a systematized approach regarding surgery, so many, many years ago. And it's interesting that the brain surface was not understood until very recently. You know, you see here Andreas Vesalius, we are in the 1600. These guys already knew the anatomy of the ventricles very well. But they thought that the distribution of the sulci and gyri was very chaotic. They didn't pay attention to this. It was only in the 1900, with Louis-Pierre Gratiolet was the first one that saw there is an organization of the gyri in the brain. They used to say, as Silvius used to say, that the brain, the convolutions of the brain had an intestinal, like the gut. It was completely chaotic. It was not organized at all. And Gratiolet showed that there is a very well organization here. We have three longitudinal gyri in the frontal surface, just as in the temporal region. Okay, and the suprasylvian part of the brain is divided by two very well-defined oblique gyri in anterior and posterior. And the posterior, the parietal region, has the intraparietal sulcus that separates the superior parietal lobule from the inferior parietal lobule. Inferior parietal lobule has the supramarginal and the angular. And the occipital region in the superlateral surface is not very well organized in men, but usually you're going to see a very well-defined superior occipital gyrus and an inferior occipital gyrus, and the middle one is much more variable. So the variations are much bigger here than in the rest of the brain, but you're always going to have this organization, and we're going to emphasize this because I want you guys to leave the room here now knowing how to recognize the main sulci. And tomorrow we're going to see lectures how to use the sulci, recognize them in surgery, and then in the lab we'll have some brains to recognize the sulci yourselves in the lab. When we go to the medial surface, it's more constant anatomically because phylogenetically it's older. We have a very well-defined inner ring that is given by the cingulate gyrus that it continues with the parahippocampal gyri. And then we have an external ring that is an extension of the basal and of the superlateral surface gyri. We're going to see this in details. Now, as I showed you in the first lecture, that the sulci, they were developed throughout an unfolding process that took place during evolution. It took millions of years for this to happen. Because of this process of unfolding process, of course, the sulci are continuous at the extremity of the gyri are continuous along the extremity of the sulci. So, and they are continuous, of course, along also the depth of the sulci. So this is what Yasegil called, it's a continuum, it's a complete continuum underneath the surface. The variations that we have are particularly important for secondary and tertiary sulci. The most important one, the main ones, are not this variable as we're going to be seeing. So I talked about these two papers, this that has this lot of access and focus. You can see all this in the literature. Gray's Anatomy, we did write this chapter about cerebral hemispheres. Everything I'm going to be talking about, sulci and gyri, is at the Gray's and at this paper. Okay, let's put our glasses. First thing regarding, particularly regarding surgery, we have an understanding that the sulci are extensions of the subarachnoid space. The pia is very much attached to the brain surface. It's impossible to remove the pia without damaging the brain surface. You see, we're seeing light reflecting here because the pia is still here. Okay? So what we remove is the arachnoid. And of course, you have the subarachnoid space here, and we have to understand the sulci. The fissures are the biggest sulci, and then the cisterns are the enlargement of the fissures at the base of the brain, and we have to understand all these compartments as extensions of the subarachnoid space. That's important because we're going to use them as surgical, microneurosurgical corridors as well. As I said, this was developed throughout an unfolding process. So you have the continuation here, the connection between some gyri. We cannot understand a gyrus as in a specific structure. When we talk a gyrus, we're saying a region. Okay, where does this region end? This gyrus end? The connection ends. Where is what's connected? So we're talking about the region. This is the precentral gyrus. This is the postcentral. Why I'm saying? Because interhemispheric fissure, you have a beautiful U here. I'm going to show you that we have some very, very clear landmarks. And the paracentral lobule is one of them. It's one of the beautiful U's we have. So when you see this, you can recognize this is paracentral lobule. This is central sulcus. We have only two vertical gyri. So it's very easy to understand. So we always going to have a connection, and of course they are also connected at the bottom of the sulci. So we have to understand both the gyri as regions and the sulci as extensions of the subarachnoid space. Now the sulci are not only continuous like the central sulcus or the Sylvian fissure. They usually, most of them are interrupted. That's why it's sort of difficult to sometimes recognize them both in MRIs and in surgery, because they are interrupted. That's why we're going to use the sulco key points in order to recognize them. Another important feature that I already mentioned two or three times, is that all the sulci of the superlateral surface and of the inferior basal surface, they are always pointing to the nearest ventricular cavity. They are always pointing. And this is very important for us in surgery, because if you're following a sulcus, you're going to reach the nearest ventricular cavity. And of course, if you have a lesion in between, you can understand this lesion in relation to what part of the ventricular cavity it is more related with and what sulci, and you can get there anatomically. This is not true for the sulci of the medial surface, because the medial surface sulci are developed after the development of the corpus callosum. That's why they are parallel to the corpus callosum. When you have an agenesis of corpus callosum, the sulci in the medial surface, they are completely disorganized. Okay, so this is an important feature, pointing always the nearest ventricular cavity. You see here an agenesis of the corpus callosum. You have just the anterior tip of the corpus callosum here developed, and you see that the sulci are all chaotic. They are not organized at all, because these sulci, they are developed according to the development of the callosum. Here you see we did remove the posterior part of the middle frontal gyrus, and you see that the superior frontal sulcus and inferior frontal sulcus are leading us naturally towards the ventricle. So this is a very important thing for us to have in mind regarding understanding the architecture. The only sulcus that you can securely identify in surgery is the Sylvian fissure, because this is due to this bending of the brain that happened throughout evolution. So of course the Sylvian fissure is always continuous, okay, always continuous. And of course the Sylvian fissure separates, lateral fissure or Sylvian fissure separates the frontal lobe from the temporal lobe. In the frontal lobe we have three main gyri, just as in the temporal lobe, superior, middle, inferior, superior, middle, inferior. We're going to be seeing that we have the superior frontal sulcus, usually continuous, a very deep sulcus. Inferior frontal sulcus is always interrupted, always interrupted. Middle frontal gyrus is the biggest gyrus we have in the frontal region. Very common for us to have a sulcus that it would be the middle frontal sulcus that we don't have in this specimen. But the superior frontal sulcus and inferior frontal sulcus is always there. Superior temporal gyrus, middle temporal gyrus, inferior. Superior temporal sulcus is very deep and usually is a continuous sulcus. We're going to see this very well. And inferior frontal temporal sulcus, just as the inferior frontal one, it's pretty much always continuous. I mean interrupted. It's always interrupted. This areas here, the superior temporal gyrus and the inferior frontal gyrus, they are called the operculum, opercular areas. Again, if you understand the names, you understand why. What does operculum mean? Operculum in Latin means curtain. So these are the curtains. Curtains of what? Curtains of the insula. They are hiding the insula. So the inferior frontal gyrus and the superior temporal gyrus, they are the insular operculum. They are covering the operculum, okay? The Sylvian fissure always has one point that it's more enlarged. It's more, I call it, has a cisternal aspect. And this point that was described as the Sylvian point, now it's called the anterior Sylvian point because we have a posterior Sylvian point, divides the fissure in a lateral aspect or posterior aspect and an anterior aspect or sphenoid part, or also in the American literature, the stem of the Sylvian fissure, the stem of the Sylvian fissure. From this point, we have always, always, always two branches of the Sylvian fissure. The anterior ascending branch, because we have a posterior ascending, anterior ascending branch, and horizontal branch. If you have two horizontal, because it's parallel to the horizon, so horizontal and anterior ascending. If you have these two branches, you always will have a triangular convolution here. This is the pars triangularis, the triangular part of the inferior frontal gyrus. Anterior to it, we have the orbital part, and posterior, we have the opercular part. This was described and called opercular part because this is covering almost the anterior half of the insula. We're going to be seeing that the pars triangularis is covering that only the most anterior short gyrus of the insula. The pars triangularis sometimes looks also as a U, not triangular as here, and you always have a small branch of the inferior frontal sulcus that it's always interrupted getting inside the pars triangularis. I told you about the beautiful U's, and I would say that the most beautiful U is the pars opercularis. It always looks like a U, always. And since this is a U, it harbors a sulcus. And this sulcus here is always, 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 always the precentral sulcus. So the precentral sulcus ends inside the pars opercularis. Pars triangularis, pars orbitalis, and this is the anterior Sylvian point. This is the stem or the anterior part of the Sylvian fissure and posterior part of the Sylvian fissure. The superior temporal sulcus usually is continuous. This case has a small interruption here, and inferior temporal always interrupted. This is another specimen here, and you can see again the triangular part very easy. You can recognize that you always have this small branch of the inferior frontal sulcus getting in here. You have this beautiful U, which is the pars opercularis, and of course, this is the precentral sulcus. This is a way of seeing the precentral sulcus. If we go more posterior, we have two other small branches. One is the anterior subcentral and posterior subcentral. Sometimes you have two anteriors or two or three posterior, but you have to take the biggest one, that it's the most important one. Why this is called anterior subcentral and posterior subcentral? Of course, you're seeing here the two very well-defined oblique gyri, that it's the central lobe, precentral gyrus and postcentral gyrus, and they are united here through the subcentral gyrus. And medially, they are united, they are connected by the paracentral lobe. Let me just come back to this specimen here. You have a more well-defined subcentral gyrus. Pars opercularis, anterior subcentral, posterior subcentral, subcentral gyrus, precentral gyrus, postcentral gyrus, central sulcus. So the so-called central lobe, is like an ellipse that it's connected here and over there by the paracentral lobe, excavated by the central sulcus. By the way, I'm saying calling this central lobe. This is not in the nomina yet. If you go to the nomina anatomica, you have the frontal lobe, you have the parietal lobe, you have the occipital lobe, you have the temporal lobe, you have the insular lobe, and recently, since the last edition of the nomina, you have the limbic lobe. The limbic lobe is the cingulate gyrus plus the parahippocampal gyrus. But since Penfield, this area that he used to be called by Penfield the central area, Yasser Gill called the central lobe. It makes a lot of sense because morphologically and functionally, they are very much together. A tumor here has nothing to do with a tumor here. So this has been called the central lobe. So the central lobe is an ellipse excavated by the central sulcus. And underneath here, the central sulcus, you have the subcentral gyrus. It turns out that the subcentral gyrus and also the base of the pars opercularis sometimes are inside the fissure, inside the Sirven fissure. So it looks like the precentral and the central would be branches of the Sirven fissure, but they are not branches because you always have this connection here, and you always have this connection here, which is the subcentral gyrus. When Broca described his area, Monsieur Le Borg, his famous patient, he said that his area was in the posterior part of the pars triangularis and anterior part of pars opercularis, in this area here. Now we know that all this region is a peri-Sylvan region, of course, is related to language, but this is a key area for the motor speech area, the so-called Broca area. So it's pars triangularis posterior, anterior part of pars opercularis. So morphology is showing something of the function. As you know, this lower part of the motor strip deals with the face, the larynx, the muscles that we use to speak. So articulation of speech happens here. So Broca area is connected directly to this area that commands our language, our motor aspects of the language. So if we come back to the specimen, we see that the subcentral gyrus is getting inside the fissure. So this is not a branch of the Sirven fissure. I bet that the central sulcus would get there, and you have to have a connection there because it's always there, this connection that it's the subcentral gyrus. Anterior subcentral sulcus, posterior subcentral sulcus. Posterior to the postcentral gyrus, of course, you have the postcentral sulcus. If you go to parietal region, you're always going to see a very, very well-defined sulcus and very deep sulcus, that is the intraparietal sulcus. Intraparietal sulcus separates the parietal lobe, divides the parietal lobe in a superior parietal lobule, which is a quadrangular lobule. And in inferior parietal lobule, also quadrangular, it's constituted by the supramarginal and by the angular gyrus. Now, if you have two gyri here, of course you have a sulcus separating them, which is the intermediary sulcus, also called intermediary sulcus of Jensen. It looks like difficult, but I'm going to repeat two or three times, and you see this is very easy and very well organized. The Sylvan fissure ends with this posterior ascending branch that always gets inside the supramarginal gyrus. The supramarginal gyrus is called supramarginal gyrus because it's around this distal part of the Sylvan fissure. That's why it's called supramarginal gyrus, okay? Posterior ascending. This is posterior Sylvan point. This is anterior Sylvan point. A point in anatomy is not a point in geometry. This is an area. So this is another area, but here it looks like marker point, posterior Sylvan point. And sometimes you have a descending branch here that it's not always present. Now, what is important is that the superior temporal gyrus, is always continuous with the supramarginal. So the supramarginal gyrus is a continuation of the superior temporal gyrus. Just like the middle temporal gyrus is continuous with the angular gyrus, and the inferior temporal gyrus is continuous with the lingual gyrus, with the inferior occipital gyrus. We're going to repeat this. Sylvan fissure ends ascending, posterior ascending part inside the supramarginal gyrus. Superior temporal sulcus ends in a point posterior to the posterior Sylvan point. And usually it trifurcates. The most superior branch is the branch that will divide the supramarginal from the angular. It turns out that this same branch can come from the interparietal, which is the same one here. This is a secondary sulcus because this is part of supramarginal since it's continuous with the superior temporal. This is the real intermediary sulcus. And it's both a branch of the intraparietal and a branch of a superior branch of the superior temporal. Sometimes you have two branches, one coming here and another one coming here, and then you have a connection between the supramarginal and the angular. Very common to have this. The supramarginal is always have this morphology, always this morphology like this U-shaped facing down with this ascending part getting inside, always. The angular gyrus here in this specimen looks like you see in the books, in the textbooks, but usually is not very well defined like this, not at all. So you call the angular gyrus region. There's the angular gyrus region. Now, coming back to the superior temporal sulcus, this superior part separates the supramarginal from the angular. But the one that it's continuous from this point always gets inside the angular, always gets inside the angular gyrus. And the inferior one, it's more anatomical, not constant. Sometimes you don't see this. It's not this important. So again, lateral fissure, Sylvan fissure, ends inside the supramarginal. Superior temporal gyrus continues with the supramarginal. Superior temporal sulcus, its most distal part, gets inside the angular gyrus. Middle temporal gyrus is continuation with the angular gyrus. And inferior temporal gyrus is continuous with the inferior occipital. In this case, we're seeing a pretty well-defined middle occipital. The superior occipital is always vertical, we're not seeing here. It's parallel to the interhemispheric fissure. Now, let me just advance and tell you that the inferior temporal continues with the inferior occipital, which will go around the corner and will be continuous with the lingual gyrus in the mesial surface. So this is a ring. So you see, you have this ring always here. You have this thing here, middle temporal with the angular always. And you have this continuation here of the superior temporal with the supramarginal. So this is very well organized. It can vary, but it's always there, very well organized. So if you come to MRI and you have, oh, I like to see anatomy in the T1 images, and I always ask them to do very lateral. By the way, when I have operator tumor, I go to radiology suite, and I see all the images they can show me there. But what space is this here? Please, you help me. The anterior sylvan point. So this is pars triangularis. By the way, I didn't emphasize that we have the anterior sylvan point because the pars triangularis is always more retracted. It's always smaller. That's why you have the anterior sylvan point. So the anterior sylvan point is always at the base of the triangular part and anterior and a little bit at the base of the pars operculare. You see the beautiful U here? So the beautiful U of the pars operculares, you're always going to see it. And when you see this, you can make sure this is the precentral sulcus, always. The so-called central lobe in the sagittal view always have this quadrangular aspect. So this is precentral, this is postcentral. This is central sulcus, this is subcentral gyrus. And of course, then this is the supramarginal. Supramarginal, and supramarginal is continuous with the superior temporal. Superior temporal. I forgot to emphasize, let me just come back here, that the intraparietal sulcus is practically always continuous with the inferior aspect of the postcentral. Particularly always continuous with the postcentral. Some authors, even current authors like Duvernoy that was mentioned here, he says that intraparietal is all this until here. This is all intraparietal. But most of anatomists call intraparietal just this part here, and this is postcentral that it's continuous here, continuous there. By the way, there's anatomy is definitions, names, and a lot of nomenclatures. All these sulci names we're using are in the book done by Ono and Yasagir. It's a famous book about sulci and gyri. And this is important because they are more neurosurgically oriented. Okay, so Ono called this the postcentral sulcus, that it's continuous here, as most authors, and this is the intraparietal. But why am I remembering this? Because if you come here, you're seeing the supramarginal gyrus. So this is postcentral sulcus. And postcentral sulcus will be continuous with the intraparietal here. Now, if you want to see the angular gyrus, we see you see here the superior temporal sulcus, and you see in the intermediary sulcus that it's separating the supramarginal from the angular. I bet that if we had a more lateral view here, we would have a small sulci going here, because it's always there. And it's this sulcus that will get inside the angular. So this is the angular gyrus. This is supramarginal, and this is angular. So if you have a cavernoma here, this is angular gyrus. So the superior temporal sulcus will separate the angular from the supramarginal, and then its more distal part will come here and gets inside the angular gyrus. And the inferior one, many times you don't have it. And of course, this is the region of the inferior temporal gyrus, inferior occipital gyrus that will go around the corner and do a ring continuous with the lingual gyrus inside. So where is this nidus of this small AVM? Exactly. You know, you can say this is in the frontal lobe, right? You can neither say this is an inferior frontal gyrus. You have to say precisely where is this. Where is it? It's in the beautiful U. It's in the anterior part of the beautiful U. So just by looking here, you see this pars operculares. And it's just behind the anterior sylvan point that it's always enlarged, always. So this is precentral gyrus, precentral sulcus. This is precentral gyrus. This is central sulcus. This is postcentral gyrus. Quadrangular shape of the central lobe. This is an anterior subcentral. This is a posterior subcentral. And you have something else here. We're going to be seeing that you have a bulging here always underneath the postcentral gyrus, that is the hashal gyrus. The postcentral gyrus is always resting over the hashal gyrus, but we come there. So if this is postcentral, what sulcus is this? What is this? This is the? So what gyrus is this? So what sulcus is this? Postcentral. So it's very easy. It's just you can start from here or you can start from here, and you're going to understand this, okay? So this is supramarginal. So posterior here, this is the angular gyrus region, right? And tomorrow we'll see the cranial landmarks, how we can figure where is this in the head of the patient for us to put our craniotomies. Okay, I always say that if I have to give a whole lecture with a single image, I would choose this slide because there's so much information here, okay? I'm putting this slide right now here because I want to talk about the other surface of the temporal lobe here, which is the opercular, the intraopercular surface, the superior surface of the temporal lobe. But of course, you're seeing the insula here. You see in the pars orbitalis that it's always bulging, and you see that the pars orbitalis is not covering the insula. That's why the pars orbitalis does not belong to the frontal parietal operculum. Frontal parietal operculum starts at the pars triangularis. You're seeing what we already talked about, which is the central core of the brain, that has as the insula as an external shield, okay, to defend that central core from the neurosurgeon, okay? We cannot come in here unless we go just superficial for an insular tumor because, of course, you have the internal capsule, basal ganglia, everything that we already talked about. So this is the central core, very well defined here. Of course, this is the lateral ventricle. What is this beautiful U here in the mesial face? Of course, you don't see any other beautiful U here. So if you see, this is paracentral lobule. It's always there and always very well defined. So let's double check. You see a vertical gyrus here, another vertical gyrus here. No, this is longitudinal. These are longitudinal also. So this is precentral, this is postcentral. This is the central lobe. This is the central lobe, like an ellipse excavated by the central sulcus. And let me emphasize, you see how posterior the paracentral lobule is? Paracentral lobule is pretty much covering the atrium already. It's very posterior. It's, as I said, you should say, things are more posterior than we think. We always, our mistakes is thinking that things are more anterior than they actually are. But let's come to what I want to show in this slide at this point. If you take the superior surface of the temporal lobe, you see two planes very well defined. An oblique one here, that it's actually covering the insula, and you see another flat one here, very flat. And they are separated by this very well defined gyrus here that goes towards the atrium always, okay, which is the, what gyrus is this? Hashal gyrus. Okay, primary auditory area. Sometimes it's double, you have two, but sometimes it's one. This is the transverse gyrus of insula. The transverse gyrus of Heschel. I forgot to tell you that inside the sulci, you have, of course, surface of the gyri. And this was developed throughout this unfolding process throughout evolution. And just to show how this process was effective, two-thirds of the cortical surface are buried inside the sulci. Two-thirds, if you consider the interhemispheric fissure as well. Two-thirds, okay? So if there was not this unfolding process, our head would be three times bigger, okay? And of course, inside the surfaces, you have small gyri. And the generic name for any small gyri inside the fissure or sulcus is transverse gyri. So transverse gyri, generic name for all gyri inside the sulcus. And it turns out that this is the bigger transverse gyrus we have because it's inside the Sylvian fissure, the lateral fissure. So this is the transverse gyrus of Heschel. And the transverse gyrus of Heschel separates the superior temporal surface in two planes. An oblique plane that it's called, easy to remember, polar plane, because it's near the pole, the temporal pole. And this other one is called temporal plane. Temporal plane is always triangular, and the apex is just next to the atrium. The easiest way to find the atrium is just to stick your finger along the Heschel gyrus. It's the easiest way, but the problem is that it's very easy to open the fissure here because it's oblique, but it's very difficult to open because it's flat, okay? And you're going to be seeing that the supramarginal gyrus is sitting here. So here it's difficult to open the fissure posteriorly. If you're going to open, you're going to damage the auditory area, and in the left dominant hemisphere, you're going to damage also the so-called Wernicke area, which is the posterior part of the superior temporal gyrus and the base of the supramarginal. By the way, all this surface we're talking about is the surface of the superior temporal gyrus. This is all superior temporal gyrus. This is the lateral aspect. This is the intra-fissure aspect, intraopercular aspect. This is all superior temporal gyrus. This is transverse gyrus, belongs to the superior. It's a transverse gyrus all inside and off the superior temporal gyrus. And it always goes posterior towards the insula, towards the atrium, I'm sorry. So if you see a fissure oblique, it's because you're anterior to the Heschel gyrus. If you see the fissure flat, the coronal cut is posterior to the Heschel gyrus. So you have to learn to see everything anatomically. I'm seeing the fissure here this way, so this has to be anterior. I'm seeing flat, has to be posterior, okay? So if I do a coronal cut anterior to here, of course the fissure will be oblique. If I do a coronal cut posterior to here, the fissure will be flat. Tomorrow we'll show a tumor that is sitting here, and you have just to recognize through a simple coronal cut. Now, if we open widely the Sylvian fissure, okay, this has a very... You see, what is this? Quick, what is this? Of course, beautiful U. It's the most beautiful U you're seeing here. So this is pars opercularis. And what is this? Precentral, very easy. So this is central, and this is postcentral, continues with intraparietal. Superior temporal continues with supramarginal, anterior, posterior ascending. So if this is opercular, what part of brain, what convolution is this? Pars triangularis. You see this another specimen, you always have the small branch coming in here. This is pars orbitalis, okay? So the so-called anterior Sylvian point here is huge. And if you open the anterior Sylvian point, underlying it, you're always going to have the apex of the insula, always, 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 always. The apex of the insula is just underneath the anterior Sylvian point. Well, this is the inferior limiting sulcus of the insula. We're going to talk about the insula shortly. And superior temporal gyrus, middle and inferior. Forgot to emphasize that the temporal pole is always a connection of the superior temporal gyrus with the inferior temporal gyrus. The middle temporal gyrus is always smaller. So you always have this morphology here of the temporal pole. But this slide is to show this. What is this here? The Heschel gyrus. You know, when you look at MRI, you have, even a normal MRI to train, you have to find the structures that are anatomically constant and can tell you where you are. That you know in the skull and you know in the patient, you know, you have to get familiar with some landmarks. And the Heschel gyrus definitely is one of them. Tomorrow we're going to see how we can use it in surgery. But at this point, you see that the Heschel gyrus runs posterior to the insula. And as I already said, the postcentral gyrus always, always sitting over the hesho gyrus. So if you know what is this, you know that this is the postcentral gyrus. Okay, so you can see the central sulcus, the precentral gyrus, the postcentral, and it's always sitting in the insula. And how do neuroradiologists recognize the hesho gyrus? By this bulging here. And this bulging here is always underneath the postcentral gyrus. So when you see this in the MRI, you know that this is postcentral gyrus, this is central sulcus. And of course, this is supramarginal. So the anatomy is very, very constant here. Okay, again, the slide to remind me that I have to start talking about the insula. And you have the huge anterior sylvian point here. And when you open the insula, you open the fissure, what you see first is the apex of the insula right there. The best paper about this opercular region was written by Ugur Ture from Istanbul. And I think he's the neurosurgeon most understand about fibers and all these things. And this is a seminal paper about this region of the operculum and of the insula. All of you should really read it. The other thing is, when you go back and you're going to dissect and to study brains, and you have to do this often, you know, you have to do it, you have to have a small lab somewhere and go there and see and dissect. Don't do brain cuttings as you learn, you know. This is mostly for anatomists. Do a surgical dissection. Remove each gyrus, gyri, see what is underneath, see the correlations. You see, for here, I just did remove what we call the frontoparietal operculum and the temporal operculum. You see that the middle temporal gyrus is not covering the insula. Just like the pars orbitalis is not covering the insula. The pars triangularis, which is here, is covering only the anterior short of the insula. So I removed the curtain of the curtains of the insula. That's how we should do our dissections to see the relationships. Okay, but we always, just like as I said, that in the callosum, corpus callosum, we always think about midline, but the fibers open everywhere. When we think about insula, we always think about the lateral aspect of the insula. But the insula has a huge anterior wall as well, as you see here. And the anterior wall is covered by the posterior orbital gyrus. Posterior orbital gyrus, we're going to see later, it looks like a Napoleon hat. And if you remove selectively the posterior orbital gyrus, you expose the anterior wall of the insula. So it has an anterior wall and a lateral wall. And it's the shield of this very important central core. Remember that the anterior half of the insula is related with the head of the caudate, hence with the anterior limb. Posterior half is related with the thalamus and with the body of the caudate, and hence with the genu and with the posterior limb of the capsule. So it's much eloquent. You see again, beautiful here, the hesho gyrus, always going towards the atrium. And remember that this central core is just on the top of the brainstem, since the thalamus, that it's posterior half of the central core, it's sort of the head of half of the brainstem. You have to have this architecture in mind always. Okay? Now, coming back to the insula is surrounded by a sulcus. This sulcus used to be called circular sulcus of the insula. It's still a name, of course, a famous name, classical name, circular sulcus of the insula. But nowadays, we divide it and call it superior limiting sulcus, inferior limiting sulcus, and anterior limiting sulcus. The superior limiting sulcus and the inferior limiting sulcus are very shallow, are just deflections from the insular surface to the opercular surface. But inferior limiting sulcus is very deep. Indeed, it's the space that it is just anterior to the huge anterior wall of the insula. And it's in then between the anterior wall of the insula and the posterior orbital gyrus. You're not seeing very well here, but again, like Italy looks like a boot, you have to know this. You know that the anterior part of the insula is covered by the posterior orbital gyrus. You have to know this, okay? Anterior limiting sulcus, superior limiting sulcus, and inferior limiting sulcus. Now, if we come to the insular surface, we see that we have a region here that it's anterior. I said that it's the apex of the insula. It's the most prominent part of the insula. You see the apex here. And you have two apexes here, but this is the main one because this is the most prominent and the most anterior. And you see gyri that come from this region, from the apex, and you see other gyri that are not related to the apex. Again, anatomy, definitions. All gyri that arise from the apex of the insula are generically called short gyri of the insula. So this one looks like a long one, but it's not long. It's short because it arises from here. The long gyri of the insula are not related with the apex. Usually you have two, and very commonly you have a single one that branches and becomes two, like a Y. This anatomy is always there. The sulcus that separates the long gyri from the short gyri of the insula is called the central sulcus of the insula. And guess what? It is continuous with the central sulcus of the brain. This organization is always there. Is this the central sulcus of the brain? Let's see. I see a vertical oblique gyrus here, a vertical one, and here I see longitudinal. So this is precentral, this is postcentral, this is central sulcus. Another way of double-checking about the central sulcus in a specimen in making sure that it doesn't receive any sulcus from anterior neither for posterior, it can receive, but usually it doesn't. It's a single sulcus in between, in the middle of this ellipse here, and it's not related with sulci from posterior or from anterior. It's alone by itself here. So this is central sulcus. This is precentral sulcus, of course. This is inferior frontal sulcus that would meet the precentral here, enlargement of when you have a meeting point area of two important sulci, usually you have an enlargement of the subarachnoid space. We're going to be using this tomorrow. So this is precentral. So of course, the pars opercularis would be here, and pars triangularis is here. This is the top of pars triangularis. It would be here because I know that the pars triangularis is covering the most anterior short gyrus of the insula, okay? I think this is Eduardo's dissection. If I do remove the surface of the insula, you can see what is real. Like Yasagil says, to see what is real, you have to remove the surface because the connections that are there, they are subcortical. So you can see that all this gyri here, this is another specimen, of course, they are coming from the single region, which is the apex of the insula. You see that the long gyrus, this is a long one that is bifurcating up there. This is the long gyrus of the insula. This would be the central sulcus of the insula. Of course, the central sulcus of the brain would be continuous here around the operculum. Now I'm going to blow here and see here. In the next slide, we'll still have the superior temporal gyrus that was removed here. By the way, you see that the middle temporal gyrus has nothing to do with the insula, nothing. If you go to the superior temporal gyrus in order to reach the ventricle, you're going to get it through the roof, okay? But it's right there because these important sulci are always directed towards the nearest ventricular cavity. But we're going to blow up here. So I'm pulling down the superior temporal gyrus, and I'm seeing the anterior short gyrus of the insula, and I see a beautiful U here. So I did remove only the pars triangularis here. This is pars opercularis, is covering pretty much the anterior half of the insula. This is subcentral gyrus. This is central sulcus. Am I right? Yes, because you see, inferior temporal inferior frontal sulcus, which is always interrupted, reaches the precentral. Reaches the precentral. Doesn't reach the central. Reaches the precentral. So this is precentral. And precentral always ends inside the pars opercularis, always. So it's like a boot in the map of Europe. It's always like this. Now, I'm seeing the apex of the insula here. I'm seeing the anterior limiting sulcus depth there. I'm seeing the inferior limiting sulcus here. And I see that there is an interruption here. Always when you have an interruption of the sulci, it's because you have a gyri going through, of course. So you're seeing a gyrus here, that it's coming from the apex towards the posterior orbital gyrus. This is the transverse gyrus of the insula, anterior transverse gyrus of the insula. Okay? And this is would be all covered by pars triangularis. And this point here, we call the limbing of insula, the limbing insula. What is the limbing insula? The limbing insula is the anterior limit of the insula that is deep in here. So the apex, very easy to expose. Just open the anterior sylvian point. Now the limbing insula is more deep, okay? If you have a middle cerebral aneurysm with a short M1, it's going to be related here. It's more difficult than having a middle cerebral aneurysm with a long M1, because aneurysm would be sitting here, would be much more easy to expose. So if you're going to operate on a middle cerebral aneurysm, the first thing you have to look and how long is the M1, because it's going to tell you how much trouble you're going to have to get more inside or less inside. So limbing insula. Now, let's understand more this space, which is a big fissure, that it's anterior to the anterior wall of the insula. So in this specimen now, besides the pars triangularis, I did remove also the pars opercularis, okay? This U now, it's the center, am I right? No, I'm sorry, this is the pars opercularis still. This is the precentral because it's receiving the sulcus from here. So I just did remove, it's the same one as before, the pars triangularis. But I'm seeing here the anterior wall of the insula, anterior wall of the insula, and I see how close I am from the ventricle, how close I am from the ventricle. And here, of course, in between, you just have the internal capsule. Of course, we are at the level of the anterior limb because we are much anterior to the foramen Monroe. This is almost the genu of the callosum. This is cingulate gyrus. And what is this bulging here? What is the, pardon? The side, what is this? The head of the caudate, right? So you see that I did expose the ventricular cavity without damaging the head of the caudate. Why? Because there is always an anterior recess of the ventricle anterior. Let me come back here, let's see if I. I do something wrong here. Okay. You see, anatomy is details. And if you want to do real microneurosurgery, these details are important. You see that you have a small recess here, just anterior to the head of the caudate, just as you have a recess anterior to the head of hippocampus. In between the hippocampus and the amygdala, inside the inferior horn, you have a recess, just as you have here. So if you cut carefully here, you're going to see this recess. That's why we didn't damage the head of the caudate. So this is a good approach, because if you have a cavernoma here, for example, you cannot come transcaloso, it's too lateral, but you can come here. Now, I'm talking about getting to the ventricle. And another thing, it's frequent to be operated at GBM here, and suddenly you have a lot of CSF, and you go, what happened? Where I am? It's because very easily here you can get inside the ventricle. You're very close to the ventricle. But only if you are superior to the level of the apex. Because if you are inferior to the apex, in this region you have the ventral striatum that we talked about in the morning, and you don't want to get in here at all. So this relationship that you can explore surgically is only being above the apex of the insula. Let's see here. If you open widely the Sylvan fissure, if you're in the right side, you can remove all this, the operculum. Otherwise, you can open the sulci and you can push this up, okay, pull this up, and you're going to see the apex. If you open the anterior limiting sulcus of the insula superior to the apex, you see the apex here. If you go anterior, see how close you are from the ventricular cavity. So again, if you have a cavernoma here, if you have a cavernoma, this is a good route to go to the cavernoma, because it would be right here. Always above the apex. If you are underneath the apex level, you're going to get into the ventral striatum. You don't want to get there. Lenticular striate arteries and a lot of stuff there. So anteriorly, you have this relationship with anterior horn, and posterior, you have the hiatal gyrus, very much related with the atrium, and in between, you have the central core. This architectural relationships, you always have to have in mind. Okay, if we look from above, what is this? What is this? Oh, of course, beautiful you here. So this is the central sulcus, okay? This is the central sulcus. And you see, what sulcus is this? Superior frontal sulcus. When it meets the precentral sulcus, okay, it enlarges. You usually have this enlargement. This is another specimen, you see? Pretty much the same. So this is the superior frontal gyrus. And very common to have a shallow sulcus in here that it's called medial frontal sulcus. But that's not superior frontal. Superior frontal is deep, about 2, almost 3 centimeters lateral, always. And superior frontal gyrus is a very well-defined region, very well-defined region. And then you have the middle frontal gyrus, which is bigger. And you always have, always have this superficial connection of the superior, of the middle frontal with the precentral. All the frontal gyri are continuous with the precentral. And that's why the precentral sulcus is always interrupted, because of these connections. The connection of the superior frontal gyrus with the precentral gyrus usually is more medial, like this one here. And what's the name of this area within the superior frontal gyrus? It's not a very well-defined area, but very, very important functionally. And we have lots of tumors arising here. SMA area. So SMA area is the more posterior and medial part of the superior frontal gyrus. As the French study, they have a cooperative French study for low-grade gliomas. They found out in some thousands of cases that 50%, 51%, if I'm not wrong, of the low-grade gliomas are in the SMA area plus insular region. The high-grade gliomas, the gliomas that start already as a high-grade, they have a different topography than the low-grade gliomas. Low-grade gliomas are more related with eloquent areas, and more than 50%, 51 or 52 of them, are in the SMA and insular region. So the number of tumors that you see here, it's unbelievable. It's very common everywhere. So you have to understand very well this region and use the superior frontal gyrus to remove these tumors. And you don't want to get posterior to it. What region is this of the precentral gyrus? How do radiologists call this area here? Omega. This is the hand neurons are here. And this superior frontal sulcus is always pointing to this region here, always pointing to this region. You see here, the omega region here. So this very important anatomy. This connection is always there, very superficial. This is post-central gyrus. This is a very old MRI, but when you look at this now, anatomically, you can understand, what is this tumor here? What, always look at this, the normal side. What is this? It has to be the precentral. It's the most anterior and vertical. So this is the, what sulcus is this? And what is this? Of course. So where is this tumor? Precentral. Going through the superficial connection to the middle frontal. Going underneath the superior frontal sulcus to the superior frontal gyrus. So this anatomy can vary, but these connections, this pattern is always there. So just by looking at this, you can understand exactly the anatomy of the tumor. And that's what you have to do with all tumors, understand correctly their anatomy. What is this? Paracentral lobule, of course. So this is central sulcus, right? Well, now we're seeing more posterior. And we see, what sulcus is this? Intraparietal, has to be the intraparietal. If this is intraparietal sulcus, what's the name of this piece of brain here? Superior parietal lobule. And what's the name of this piece of brain? If this is the inferior parietal lobule, what gyrus is this? Supramar, you see? Very easy, because you come from very well-known landmarks. And what gyrus is this? Angular. Tomorrow, what gyrus is this? It's the supramarginal, because the supramarginal is always the most prominent gyrus in the lateral aspect and posterior aspect of the brain. So these things are always like this. So if you have a cavernoma here, you look at that, this is supramarginal cavernoma. If it's here, angular cavernoma, okay? Always like this. So this is the superior temporal sulcus that it's ending in here. Okay, we saw a beautiful U with the opercular part of the inferior frontal gyrus. A second beautiful U, paracentral lobule. Now we see another beautiful U here, a little bit more variable. But usually you have this beautiful U. To understand better this beautiful U, let's understand what is this here. What was this? What is this? Calcarine fissure. Even if you don't know, you should say, because it's the fissure that goes more posterior. Tip of the occipital lobe, it's called opisthocranium here in the skull. We are mammals, we are visual animals, so our calcarine fissure is long. So calcarine fissure goes until the tip of the brain here. So what gyrus is this? Lingual. And this is the? Cuneus. This is calcarine. What sulcus is this? Parietal-occipital. Parieto-occipital sulcus should be called parieto-occipital fissure. Some people do, because it's very deep. It's so deep that you always have this fissure here. Always have this, how they call now, it's, I'll remember, incisure. Always have this incisure. And it ends here. If it ends, it's because you have a connection. This connection here was called, it's called the parieto-occipital connection of Gratiolet. Gratiolet was the most important anatomist to understand the surface of the brain. He described also the optic radiation. I showed this morning the channel of Gratiolet in the globus pallidus, where you have the anterior commissure. And this is the parieto-occipital connection of Gratiolet. Always there. It's another beautiful U, always. And this is always very deep. Very, very deep, because this is the depth of the parieto-occipital fissure. And of course, this separates what is parietal lobe than what is occipital lobe. Let me just come back here. You said this is the? So what's the name of this piece of brain here? Precuneus. So you start seeing that the precuneus is the same piece of brain as the superior parietal lobule. The same piece of brain, but here it's called superior parietal lobule. If you look here, it's called precuneus, but it's the same piece of brain. Okay? Inferior temporal gyrus. What gyrus is this here? Inferior occipital. Let's come back here. Inferior occipital. And what gyrus is this? Let's come back here. Sorry. What gyrus is this? It goes around the corner and it's the inferior occipital. As I was saying in the beginning, this is a ring here. You see, inferior temporal, inferior occipital, and lingual. You see, it's a ring. Just like the cingulate and the parahippocampal is another ring. This is an external and medial ring here. It's always there. Well, so what piece of brain is this? Cuneus. Calcane fissure, lingual gyrus, continues laterally with the inferior occipital. Now, the interparietal sulcus, when reached this point, has to change the name. It starts the interoccipital. Of course, this is occipital lobe. Anatomy, lots of names, also called superior occipital sulcus. Interoccipital sulcus or superior occipital sulcus is the same thing. The thing is, this piece of brain here, vertical, is the superior occipital gyrus. Superior occipital gyrus is always vertical, always parallel to the intermespheric fissure. And superior occipital gyrus is the same piece of brain as cuneus. Just like superior parietal lobule is the same piece of brain as precuneus. Of course. So the superior occipital gyrus is always pretty well defined. Here it's not defined, but I would say it's this area here. Inferior occipital, always very well defined. The middle occipital that is in this side is very well defined. It's not very well defined in many specimens. This area is the most variable area that we have in human brains. So intraparietal, intraoccipital, or superior occipital. Intraoccipital or superior occipital. This region is the superior occipital gyrus region. This is the middle occipital, and this is inferior occipital. Superior parietal lobule continues with the precuneus. Superior occipital gyrus continues with the cuneus. Inferior occipital gyrus continues with the lingual gyrus. Just like the supramarginal continues with the superior temporal, angular continues with the middle temporal. So if you know this key informations, you're going to recognize everything. And if you know where they are in relation to the skull, you're going to understand the lesions in relation to the gyri and sulci, and hence then to the skull, what we're going to try to show tomorrow. So you have to know these relationships. The medial surface is much more constant, okay? You have above the callosum, of course, you have the callosal sulcus. callosal sulcus or callosal cistern also, because you have the pericallosal artery, you have a lot of CSF here, as you know, callosal cistern. And then you have the cingulate gyrus. Cingulate gyrus continues with the parahippocampal gyrus. This was called by Broca the limbic gyrus, and nowadays it's called the limbic lobe. Okay? Superiorly to the cingulate gyrus, superior you have the cingulate sulcus. Cingulate sulcus, of course. Cingulate sulcus always arises here, and this is called the distal part, the terminal part of the cingulate sulcus. Very deep. It delineates posteriorly this beautiful U here, which is the paracentral lobule. So this is central sulcus. Paracentral lobule then has the distal terminal part of the calcane of the cingulate sulcus, and anteriorly has a sulcus that has to be called paracentral sulcus. Paracentral sulcus, a branch of the cingulate sulcus. Distal part of cingulate, paracentral sulcus. Paracentral lobule. This thing belongs to the paracentral lobule because it's anterior to this deep sulcus. This is a secondary distal part of the cingulate. You have secondary, you have tertiary, you know, and you have to understand that it can be double. You know, you take the orbital sulcus, for example, has an H format. Sulcus is not linear. It can be interrupted, it can be double, it can be curved, okay? Sulcus is a concept. Paracentral lobule. Everything that it's anterior is the medial surface of the superior frontal gyrus. Some people call this medial frontal gyrus, but this is wrong because this is the medial frontal sulcus is very shallow. So this is the medial aspect of the superior frontal gyrus. So what is this region here again? SMA. And again, you see that the paracentral lobule is sitting over the atrium. We're seeing the anterior horn and the body of the ventricle. We're not seeing the atrium because the atrium is it's not in the midline. It's right there, and it's posterior. You remember that the splenium ends here, but opens there and opens here. And the splenium, it's posterior to the end of the splenium in the midline. The atrium will be here. Okay. So this is superior frontal gyrus. And superior frontal gyrus is always continuous with this gyrus here. What's the name of this gyrus? What's the name of this gyrus here? You see the olfactory tract here. Gyrus rectus. Okay. Superior to the gyrus rectus, you always have one sulcus that it's called superior rostral. Remember that everything that is facing down is rostral. This is the rostrum of callosum, geno of callosum, rostrum. So this is the superior rostral sulcus. And inside the gyrus rectus, you always have the inferior rostral sulcus, always. When the superior rostral sulcus ends, is because you have a connection. This connection was called by Yasagil the cingulate pole. Cingulate pole. It's anterior to the parafactor region that we're going to see shorter. So this is the cingulate pole. The cingulate pole is always the connection between the cingulate gyrus and the rectus gyrus around the distal end of the superior rostral sulcus. The inferior rostral sulcus is always inside the rectus gyrus. And the rectus gyrus is very thin, but it's very high. Rectus gyrus always continues with the superior frontal gyrus, always. Again, this is the calcane fissure, parietal-occipital sulcus. Precuneus. You have a multiple Y here that it's called subparietal sulcus. good name because it's under the parietal lobe. This is parietal lobe, and this is limbic lobe. This is limbic lobe. This multiple Y here is subparietal. Anatomy definitions. The beginning of the calcium fissure is what separates. It's where the parahippocampal gyrus begins. From here up, cingulate. But this part that it's around the splenium here has a different name. Does anybody know? It's a piece of brain that puts together the cingulate and the parahippocampal. It's the isthmus. Okay? The name, the right name is just isthmus, but people speak isthmus of the cingulate gyri. That's fine, isthmus. It's more thin. This is the base of precuneus, and this is isthmus. And the parahippocampal gyri, the isthmus ends here. Where you have the beginning of the calcium fissure, from here, inferiorly, you have the parahippocampal gyrus. Of course, this is the uncus. And you have the uncus-sulcus that it's ending inside the uncus. This is uncus-sulcus. PCA comes here and gets into the calcium fissure, or just over it. And then it divides here in parieto-occipital artery and calcarine artery. When you go midline here, intermispheric, see the arteries. And you're going to see this bifurcation here. And you know you are at this point. And then you have the more proximal part of PCA here. Cingulate gyrus, rectus gyrus, superior rostral sulcus, inferior rostral sulcus. What's the name of this connection here that I said?
Cingulate pole.
Cingulate pole, Yasagil's name. This is the fornix, column of the fornix. This is the, what is this that runs anterior to the fornix?
Anterior
commissure. You can see that in between the cingulate pole and the fornix, I mean the anterior commissure, you have three small gyri. The first one is the paraterminal, and then you have the posterior parolfactory and the anterior parolfactory. The paraterminal gyrus here receives the inducium grisium. What is this here?
Hippocampus.
Continues with the fornix. We have the gyrus fasciolaris, not shown here, that goes around the splenium, coming from the hippocampus, and then becomes the inducium grisium over the hippocampus. Over the callosum. And the inducium grisium will end at the parateterminal gyrus, inside the parateterminal gyrus. And what do we have in here, inside here? We have the septal nuclei. So septum in anatomy means what is in the midline, septum. Means what is in the midline. So this is the real septum. Why real septum? Because you have neurons in here, septal area. Very important neurons. The septal neurons, the septal area, is the gateway to the hypothalamus. Everything that comes from the cortex to go to the hypothalamus goes through the septal nuclei. So this is very important. You have the septal syndrome, all this that you know. And the septum pellucidum is the false septum. You have no neurons. This is just a membrane, which is the medial wall of the anterior horn and of the body of the ventricle that we talked about. But this is septal area. Septal area, if you go lateral, you continue with the ventral striatum, and you will be continuous with the temporal stem. Tomorrow, if we have time, we'll come back to this region with another dissections. Parofactory area of Broca, cingulate pole, okay, and you have the fornix here. What is the name of this membrane here? Lamina terminalis. It goes from the anterior commissure to the chiasm. This is the anterior wall of the ventricle. What artery do you have sitting here? The AECOM. And the AECOM has a small trunk that goes to the cingulate pole, to the pyrolefactory area, and also to the fornix. That's why when you have ischemia of this area, you have memory problems and you have behavioral problems. That this is this syndrome that is very common in AECOM aneurysm that you see very frequently because of the small artery that is bringing oxygen to this region here. Now, let's understand, we understood this area here. Let's understand now this important area here where you have the temporal, where you have the parahippocampal gyrus. If we blow this region here, we do a zoom. Of course, you're seeing the thalamus. You're seeing the uncus, uncosuccus. You see there the fimbria, dentate nuclei. What's the name of this flat surface of the temporal parahippocampal gyrus, this flat surface here? Yeah, just lateral to the dentate nuclei? Subiculum, yes. Okay. Can you tell me what is this? Exactly, it's the calcium fissure. You see how deep the calcium fissure is? And sometimes the PCA gets inside there. This is the calcium fissure. This is corpus callosum. This is a splenium. This is the isthmus. You see that the parahippocampal gyrus is just like the stem of a big tree. And the main branch, everybody thinks that it's the cingulate, but it's mostly the lingual. The parahippocampal gyrus indeed is a continuation of the lingual gyrus, as you can see here, but of course also of the cingulate through the isthmus. And it's interesting that the corpus callosum gets inside here, as you're seeing here, the splenium gets inside. This is a very interesting anatomy. And of course, this is the base of precuneus. And you see that the precuneus is giving a connection there, a branch that is also coming here. Okay, also coming here. Indeed, the brain began here. It began along the hippocampus that is buried in here with the parahippocampal gyrus, and then the rest of neocortex, of course, was developing. So this is just like the stem of a tree where the main contributions are the lingual gyrus and the isthmus that comes from the cingulate gyrus. And you have a small contribution of the precuneus that will come in here. So this is how the parahippocampal gyrus is. Now, if we come to the MRI, as I said, very easy. You see everything that we talked here. What is this here? Paracentral lobule. How do the neuroradiologists recognize the paracentral lobule? They see this very deep sulcus here. This very deep sulcus is exactly the distal part that I showed of the cingulate gyrus. That's how they recognize the posterior part of the paracentral lobe. Always when you have this very deep, you have the paracentral lobule here. And what's the name of this sulcus here? Paracentral. You see, of course, this is not the same MRI of this brain, but you see it's exactly the same. You see here the multiple Ys, which are the subparietal. This is very constant. You see, subparietal sulcus, paracentral gyrus. This is the paracentral sulcus, and this is the superior frontal gyrus. You always have this connection of the cingulate also with the superior frontal. You always have this. You see how interesting? You always have this. And we are seeing here the superior rostral. I'm sorry, the superior rostral here. This is the cingulate pole, and this is the inferior rostral down there. This is rectus gyrus. If we come in here, we're not actually seeing the sulci, we're seeing the flow void of the PCA, as I said. You see the PCA here, and then it bifurcates in parieto-occipital artery and calcarine artery. This is the calcarine artery flow void. And this is, what gyrus is this? Lingual. This is the cuneus here, and this is the precuneus. You see how it's easy to recognize, particularly in the medial surface, very, very common. Okay, we're almost getting to the end.
The inferior surface of the frontal lobe, of course, is the frontal orbital surface. Temporal pole, you see that the temporal pole is the superior temporal and the inferior temporal gyrus. What is this here? The uncus. And what's the name of this sulcus here? That it's separating the uncus from the rest of the temporal pole. It's separating paleocortex from neocortex. This is the rhinosulcus. Rhinosulcus, as we're going to see, is very frequently continuous with the collateral sulcus. This is the stem of the Sylvian fissure. Okay. This the orbital surface harbors the orbital sulcus. Sorry. Orbital sulcus has this H format. And sometimes you have two bars here, but and separates what is lateral orbital gyrus, anterior orbital gyrus, and medial orbital gyrus. And then you have the olfactory fissure, and then you have the rectus gyrus. Okay. Now, as I said, the posterior orbital gyrus always resembles, looks like a Napoleon hat. I always say this because it really does look. So this part of the brain belongs to the anterior orbital gyrus. If we see another specimen, you see another Napoleon hat here, another Napoleon hat. So this is posterior orbital gyrus. And the posterior orbital gyrus is covering what? If I remove this selectively, what will I be exposing? The anterior surface of the insula. That's what I want. I want you to know this because that's the way to have the architecture of the brain in your mind, you know. So next time you open the stem of the Sylvian fissure, you're going to see the bifurcation of the carotid here. A1 will be here, M1 will be here. And just posterior, you know that you have the perforate substance. You're not going to see it because of the pterional angle. But you know that posterior to M1, A1, you have the anterior perforate substance, okay? And when you're going along here, you know that superior to your approach, you have the posterior orbital gyrus. And if you do remove this, or if you have a tumor here, you have posterior to it, the anterior wall of the insula. You have always to have an X-ray vision. You have to know what is posterior, what is superior. You have to know where you are, okay? So you have this H format also, always. Medial orbital gyrus, rectus gyrus. Very thin but very high interhemispheric fissure. This is the olfactory fissure. It's very deep, the olfactory fissure also. If we go to the base, we have a very well-defined sulcus that goes from posterior until anterior. What is sulcus is this? The collateral sulcus. Parahippocampal gyrus. What gyrus is this in the base of occipital region? The lingual, of course. Has to be the lingual. It's not written, but it's the base of the occipital, so it has to be the lingual. So if this is the parahippocampal, this is the isthmus going around the splenium here. So collateral, and what gyrus is this one? And what gyrus is this one? Inferior occipital. And what gyrus is this? That's what's left in the middle here. Very well defined in this side. And this side is not very well defined. But what gyrus is this? Yeah, somebody said here. What about someone in the left? What gyrus is this here? Fusiform. Don't be afraid. This is the fusiform. Some people call this lateral occipitotemporal, and the lingual they call medial occipitotemporal. But forget this. This is called lingual, and this is fusiform. So the collateral sulcus separates posterior here, the inferior, the lingual, from the inferior occipital, and then separates the parahippocampal from the fusiform and ends here. And then you have the renal sulcus. Very frequently, this is continuous. In this case, not this much. This is rhinosulcus. This is all hippocampus. This is temporal pole. Rhinosulcus separates the uncus from the rest of temporal pole. This is rhino. This is rhinosulcus. Fusiform. If we go here, what gyrus is this in the medial? It has to be parahippocampus, the most medial one. So what gyrus is this here? Fusiform. What sulcus is this? This is the collateral. And I forgot to tell you the name of this sulcus here. Does anybody know? This is the occipitotemporal sulcus. This is collateral. And this is occipitotemporal. And the occipitotemporal, very, very frequently merges together with the collateral anterior. You say, well, where is the fusiform gyrus in this site? Fusiform gyrus is called fusiform because usually has this form of a fuse here, very well defined. And its tip is always at the level of the brainstem. It doesn't go more anterior. Fusiform gyrus end here. And we're going to be seeing tomorrow, even today if we have 5 minutes more, that the fusiform gyrus is the floor of the inferior horn. The anterior half of the fusiform gyrus is the floor of the inferior horn. And the posterior half of the fusiform gyrus is the floor of the atrium. So the fusiform gyrus don't go more posterior, don't go more anterior. So in this area, I would say this is the tip of fusiform gyrus. This is the tip. This is fusiform gyrus here. And this is a connection that I would call this fusiform gyrus too. I would call all this fusiform gyrus area because this is inferior temporal. So this is all fusiform for me. And it has an anterior extension here. But this is the end of the real fusiform. Sorry, I'm about to finish. Let's see if there's anything else. Well, I talked a lot about the anterior substance. I think I'll end here because I already talked about this. So we can save some time. I already talked here 1 hour and a half. Okay.